let's go for the last lecture. And as I know that you are all very fresh, I can rush through all this very quickly. So I have a little bit more extra time to tell you something else to start with. So this is a nice picture. This is actually an artist's view of a cold atom experiment. In my earlier time, in another life, I had more time and I had friends which were artists, and artists typically, they are broken, they have no money, and we get paid for what we do, so we are lucky. You're lucky, you get paid for your PhD. So I told him, okay, I give you some money, because he's a friend, but you have to do something. So you have to paint the ceiling of my flat in Paris. I was in Paris at the time. And he said, okay, good deal. So he went to visit the lab and everything, and this is his artist view of what we do. So this is supposedly, this is a vacuum chamber with rubidium trapped in. This is me looking at the atoms, and these are colleagues around, and that's how he thinks we work. But okay, so why not? Okay, now let's go to a little bit more serious stuff. Okay, so yesterday I finished half of my second lecture about Kuhn backscattering. So it was a wave effect in multiple scattering. And now we come to the other part, which is super and subradiants, and where we now will move to a different approach, which means a different numerical code, which I will show you as well, which is complementary to what we have seen so far. Okay, so I will start with an ab initio model for light scattering. I mentioned in the last lecture that for Anders localization, there was no exact theory. There was microscopic numerical toy models. We also will use toy models to do numerics, but we think that our toy model applies and is derived from an ab initio Hamiltonian approach. So this is what we in AMO physics like. We start from Hamiltonians and we derive equations, and I would call this ab initio exact theory, but okay, that's a matter of taste. And then I will show you some experiments. Okay, so the main thing is something we heard, or you heard a lot about by Anna and Antoine, it's resonant dipole-dipole interactions, because when we speak about scattering of light by many atoms, so again, remember, you are all cold atoms, and I sometimes throw a photon at you. If I throw a photon at you, you will oscillate. So it's a scattering problem. It's not a spontaneous emission. So you will oscillate, you are dipole, and then you will interact with another dipole here. So it's a dipole-dipole interaction. Okay. So this dipole-dipole interaction has some green function to propagate from one dipole to the other. This is given here. It has near-field terms, which goes like 1 over r cubed, and far-field terms, which go like 1 over r. So the 1 over r part is really the part which will radiate out of the sample and go to the detector many, many centimeters or meters away. The 1 over r cubed part is the part where there are no propagating photons. So the near-field term is also the static term, so this has an angular dependence given here. And I will mainly not go into too much detail except in the last part of the third lecture where this will be important. So I will use a very rough approximation, which we call the scalar approximation. So I drop all these terms and just keep the 1 over r part here. So polarization is lost, near-field terms are lost, so it's completely wrong. But we'll see that it captures many features we can see in the experiment. So it's like a miracle that this wrong simplified picture works so well. But it works, so that's why we use it. OK, so how do we derive an ab initio model for light scattering by many atoms? So the idea is the following. So we come in with a laser beam here. We drive our cloud of cold atoms here. And if you consider the atom J here, so what I will consider is the amplitude of this dipole. So it will oscillate, and it is driven by the external laser field. So this is so I can write the equation of motion of this dipole here, which is given here. So it's driven by the external laser field with a rubber frequency omega. It has some phase depending where this atom is positioned here, k0 r j. k0 is the incident wave vector. And then it has some free evolution term. It depends on the detuning of this layer compared to the atomic resonance frequency. And there's a decay rate of this optical coherence. So this you get from optical block equations, basically. It's an equation of evolution of the optical coherence of the optical block equation. I'm in the linear optics regime, so low drive, linear optics. And then the more interesting part is that this dipole J will not only see the field coming from the external laser drive, which I impose on the system, but it will also see the field scattered by all the other dipoles. And this makes the thing interesting. And so this dipole M here will radiate some radiation to dipole J with this green function here. So it will decay away. So the further away atom J and atom M are, the lower this amplitude is. And there's an oscillating part here. So this is, OK, it's an equation you can derive from classical antenna theory. You can also derive it a different way. I will show you next slide. But this is the model we will use extensively and see what type of physics is captured in this quite simple equation. And there's a lot of physics in there. And so far, we think there's more physics hidden in this equation than in the random walk equation, which I showed you on the first lecture. And so I can solve this equation. And once I know the evolution of every dipole here, I can also can compute the field which is scattered, which is just given by the scattered field by all the dipoles. So once I know the solution for every dipole, I can also compute what I can detect in the experiment. OK, and we like this for reasons which will maybe become clear at the end of the third lecture. We'll see. OK, so this equation here is what you have to keep in mind. It can be derived from a full Hamiltonian. I will not go through all this. We suffered a bit from Anna's talk about how to make this equation, rotating wave approximation, different terms. All this is in here. And I just will use the simple equation at the end, which I just showed you. I will not go through this because of yesterday evening was a little bit long. So let's skip this part. Just keep the result. We use this equation. You can read through this. There are a lot of papers how to derive this. OK. Beyond linear optics, again, you can do more fancy things. I skip it. Just too many things. OK, let's just keep the linear optics part to else I will lose you, I think. So it's I try to keep you awake. That's that's the goal. OK, so I take this set of equations I just showed you before, and I apply it to a system, let's say a spherical cloud of cold atoms. And I solve this equation with an instant laser beam here. And obviously, this laser will scatter light in all directions. And so this is the plot of the emitted intensity in the far field. And so you see a fluctuating field here, around here. You see a bright spot here. And the laser comes from comes from behind. What I plot here is the azimuthal average of this picture here. So this is a speckle feature. So this is what we already saw in the last lecture. Obviously, there will be a speckle pattern coming out. It's multiple scattering involved, lot of single scattering involved. So there will be speckle patterns. So this equation also has speckle. So that's no big surprise. And so what I plot here is in the blue line is the azimuthal average here, and maybe a configuration average about different polarization of this scattered light. So what you see is there's the blue line behind these black points. And there's a big peak here. And then there's a small thing here. So the big peak here is very easy to understand. You can consider this cloud of cold atoms just as a piece of dielectric. And you make a smooth, homogeneous approximation. So this behaves like a lens, a piece of glass, a sphere of glass. So you have a lens in effect. So this plane wave here will just have a focus here, a lens. And this is just a far field diffraction of this lens. So this blue line here, you can get from a mean field approximation just by taking alpha, the effective average index of refraction of this cloud. And then you can get this light here. So most of the light will be in the forward direction. So it's known that don't look in the laser beam with your remaining eye. You know this, right? OK. the first one you can try. Don't do it with the second one. But so this experiment is quite difficult because you have to look close to the forward direction. But so Junji was able to see this enhanced peak here. And this is well reproduced by this model. So this works well. So OK, so this is understood, mean field physics. Then here, there's this wavy line here. And there's the black points here. The black points here are derived from the random walk model from the first lecture. So you see that in most of the directions, except when you look in the laser beam, the random walk model is very good. So the random walk model, we don't need this fancy wave model. Most of the directions here are well described by a random walk model. Okay, but at least this coupled dipole model also includes the random walk model. So it also includes multiple scattering. Okay, so this equation here again, it has the mean field, integral fraction, and it has multiple scattering included. And then we also see this peak here, which I hope you remember. What is this? This is Cohen backscattering. OK, that's what we saw the last lecture. So this model also has current backscattering included. Okay. So we like this model because that everything we see so far is included in this set of equations. So we think it's a more general way of describing things than the random walk where we add the phases and we play dirty tricks to recover some results. Okay, so this is what's called weak localization. Okay, so this scalar approximation captures the mean index, multiple scattering, speckle, current backscattering. Okay, so we have to be careful that sometimes it's wrong. I said it's approximation, so don't over interpret and estimate what this model has, but it's very useful. Okay, and maybe, I didn't put it here, I should put it here, you'll see later in the lecture, I will try to wake you up a little bit. We don't have analytic results for everything we can detect. So maybe from this easy model, someone of you can come up with an analytic result of the curves I will show you. If you are able to do it, come and see me and we publish a paper. So we are not able to do it, basically, so we don't know how to do it. Okay, and then, so this is one thing. The other part now is we go for time-dependent scattering. So all this was steady state. The laser's on, I look in the old direction, so that's steady state results. It's not time-dependent results. Now I go for time-dependent results. And for this, I come back to this picture we saw by Anna and Antoine, maybe in both lectures. So the Dicke type of approach. So Dicke in the 50s introduced what will happen when you have many two-level systems close together and coupled to the same radiation mode. And so if you take this energy diagram here, this state here is where all the atoms are in the ground state, all spins down. This state here is all spins up, all atom excited, completely inverted system. And then here there's one excitation, so there are n possibilities to excite one atom, and so on. So we have a full diagram here of different energy states. And the most striking result, the most important thing coming out of this is that if you start from the fully inverted system here, you will cascade down, and you will cascade down with a very fast time scale, much faster than if you have independent atoms. So this is called super radiance, super fluorescence, I would call this. This has been measured by Feld in a molecular experiment in the 70s. So this is well studied, and this is something I will not discuss. Okay, I will not discuss what happens when you start from a fully inverted system, because this is many photons, many excitations. I will stay in the single excitation sector, so only at most one excitation. So I zoom on this single excitation sector, and there's one common ground state, there are n single excited states, and I can take the symmetric state here and all the other more or less antisymmetric states. And what you can see is that this symmetric state here has a faster decay rate than the antisymmetric states, so this decays n times faster. So this can be understood if you take two atoms, if you have two atoms together, if they're close together, they will also, if they oscillate in phase, they have a large dipole, and then the emission rate, which goes like dipole squared, is faster than twice the independent atoms. So this is a super radiant a giant dipole, and all the other states are the antisymmetric states where the atoms oscillate out of phase, and they behave like a quadrupole, like a generalized quadrupole, multipole, and they don't radiate. So this subradiant state are these antisymmetric states here, which should not radiate if they're very close together. And depending on the separation between the two atoms, of course, if the atoms are very far away, then you recover the single atom, independent atom decay system. Okay, so this has well understood. Now we have to generalize this a little bit because in our experiment, what we have typically is a sample size, which is of the order of a few millimeters, anyway, much larger than the wavelength. So we have to be a little bit more careful about this Dicke model, which is typically considered in the small volume limit. So what happens in the large volume limit? So I give you now a picture here. It's a picture. It's more or less, it's reproduced by numerics, but it's not completely derived from an analytical approach. So what's the picture? If I have many atoms in a single very small volume, all these atoms share the same optical mode. And that's why I have this n times enhancement factor of the decay rate. If I have a larger volume, let's say, so we are all called atoms, we are here in a box. So the question is, how many optical modes do we have here available? And I have as many optical modes here as I can put lambda squares on the wall of this room, okay? Because every photon needs a lambda square exit door, okay? It's a loose picture, but okay. So let's consider this and see how far we can go. So if you have, so how many optical modes do I have L squared, the surface of the room, divided by lambda squared. So that's the number of optical modes I have available for you to get rid of your photons if you're excited. And then I make the ratio, how many atoms do we have compared to how many modes are there available? So this number here, n at over n modes. This is a kind of a cooperativity number. If you have more modes than atoms, every atom can exit by one door independently. But if there are more atoms than doors available, you have to arrange yourself. You have to discuss how do you get out. So if this number here is larger than one, then there will be some new cooperativity effect which will enter. And this is the same thing as what you have in a cavity. If you have a cavity with a single mode cavity, the cooperativity factor of a cavity experiment will be increased with the number of atoms in the cavity. If you have a single mode, if n equals, if this is one, that's the cooperativity enhancement you get. So here we have the same thing. How many atoms compared to how many modes you have? So this number here, B0, you will see it until the end of my talk and even next third lecture. So this is our favorite number. Everything we plot now is a function of this B0. Because it's a relevant number for this cooperativity effect, and also we can measure it easily in the experiment. Because if you compute this, B0 is number of atoms divided by KL squared, and this is the on-resonance optical depth of a cloud of cold atoms. So that's the number we can measure in the experiment. So we can measure the x-axis and plot some observable in the y-axis. Okay. One thing, so spontaneous emission versus coherent scattering. So again, this is a scattering problem. So we are interested in the optical coherence part here. If I would just have single atom, would have this gamma here and this driving field here. Sometimes in some communities, if you have dephasing collisions, you put the gamma star here. I don't know if you have seen this. This is, we have an oscillating dipole, and if something perturbs this dipole on an effective single atom response, it's sometimes described by this effective dephasing rate here. So the question is, can we do this in our coupled dipole model? And basically, the answer is do it and come back to me. So that's homework number one, okay? So one thing to do, I wanted to have this on the second lecture so that I would collect all your input today, but okay, it's too late. So you send me an email. Try to extract an effective gamma star here, a dephasing rate, from the coupled dipole equation. And what is the expression of gamma star, okay? If you can do it analytically, you get a bonus. Numerically, it's not so bad, okay? So, and then write me, write Mathilde, we'll share it, and we'll see. The result, I don't know how to do it, so it's not, but if you know how to do it, you have a WhatsApp group, okay? Share it, and we have a paper together, like Lesouch 2019 consortium. We'll ask Jean-Michel to write the paper, he knows how to write papers, and then we do this paper. So what, okay, try to find this gamma star, here, okay? That will, might be possible, someone has to think about it. And typically, collectively, we know more than individually, right? We like collective effects, so we have a collective crowd here to find the collective answer. Okay, then we go back to numerics. Okay, so this was a kind of hand-waving arguments. Now we'll go for numerics. We take this coupled dipole equation, which I showed before. We switch on the laser field and switch it off again, so rubber frequency go on and off. And then we look at what happens. So I have my laser field going like this. That's the Rabi frequency as a function of time. And I will now look at what happens in this region here. Okay, when I switch off the laser, if you solve this equation, you will see something which is has a, so if you have a single atom, that's the dotted line here. That's the log scale here. So that's exponential minus gamma t. And if you have more atoms in the sample, you see something decaying faster and then slower again. And this is for the single excitation sector. So it's not an inverted system initially. So this we call super radiance because it's faster, and this we call subradiance because it's slower. And if you look at the how this time scale, this particular this subradiant time scale scales, you see that the decay rate goes linear with one over the optical thickness, which means that the decay time is proportional to this cooperativity number. Okay. Simulation. So let's do it in the code. I sit down, take my glasses. I switch to MATLAB, so there's this coupled dipole model now. Okay, open this. Okay, let's look at this. So the code is different, so we have to go and walk through the lines. It's not the same, it's not just an add-on on the random walk line, it's a different code, okay? So what do we have? We have the parameters here. Okay, I put one here, this we could skip the detuning. I have to choose the detuning. In this equation, there was a detuning delta. There was omega. I put it 0.1, but I have linear equation, so it doesn't really change anything. It's a can put 10. It's a just put 0.1 to make it look consistent, but this number will not change anything. The number of atoms, because I have n couple of equations, I have beta j dot, so I have n equations, so I have to say how many equations I want to solve. And here I take 1,000, which is okay for now. If you take 10,000, it will take longer, and above 10,000, we are not able to do it on my laptop at least, so it's getting harder. Then we have to, okay, we have to choose a geometry. So here I take a spherical cloud of radius kr5, choose a time step. This is a bad code, but at least we can read it. Don't do it like this if you want to be efficient, but okay, we'll just. And then, okay, how long do I keep the laser pulse on? And then how long do I run the simulation? Okay, this is choosing the position of the atoms, okay, random cloud. So actually it's a random homogeneous sphere. It's not a Gaussian sphere. If you put an N over here, if you put an N here, it's a Gaussian sphere. But okay, this is, then, okay, we have to compute in this green function, there was e to the I k r j minus r m and over k r j minus r m. So I have to compute all the relative distances. Okay, so this is done here. So it looks a little bit tricky. So this is just to compute all the relative distances between the atoms. And that's the absolute value of these different positions. Then I compute the green function. So e to the, that's I and kr, that's actually kr over kr. Okay, that's the long range part. Then if you do it like this, you get actually values on the diagonal. But I have to, this green function is only for j different from m, so I have to take away the diagonal part here. And then I compute this matrix here, minus gamma over 2 plus delta, the free evolution term, times the single atom decay rate. And then this is this green function here. I add the laser field, the drive of the laser field, which is the phase of the position long z of this atom. And then I can compute the steady state solution. And then I go for the time step. So this is the bad thing. Don't do a time solution here with the linears, just a linear step. That's very bad because you add numerical errors every step you do. If you do smaller steps, you do more steps, it's not a good idea. I do it, but it's not a good idea. The better thing is to take a Runge-Kutta method. I also show it here. Okay, so it's a little bit better. But there are even better ways than this to do it. But it's just, you can read exactly what I do. Okay. The beta of every atom at the function t is the beta of t minus 1 plus this evolution of the derivative of the equation of evolution. And then I sum up the population. So I look at how many atoms are excited. So I only plot the total population after some time. After if I switch off the laser, the atoms will decay. So the steady at long time, it has to go to zero. Okay, and then this is when I switch on the laser. There's an omega here, laser drive. Then I switch off the laser after this pulse duration. Same equation, but this value here is zero. There's no Rubber frequency here. And then I just also show the single exponential decay as a reference. And then I plot the result. Okay, so it's not very lengthy. You need to have a time evolution. The only thing which is complicated is this beta evolution. So you need to derive this green function, but it's not really hard. Okay, let's run this, and I think so this is a little bit longer, so now it's you have to diagonalize an n by n matrix sometimes, so this is a little bit length, takes more time, so it's very difficult to simulate an experiment where you have 10 to the 9 or 10 to the 10 atoms. It's impossible. So, but I want to simulate a cooperativity effect, so I want to simulate something where, let me just check if this is running, yes, I want to simulate something where we have a large B0. So if I only can simulate 1,000 atoms, I cannot have them in 1 millimeter, else optical depth will be very small. So that's why I choose this value here, kr equals 5, which is much smaller than the experiment, but that's the only way how I can simulate cooperativity effect on the computer. And here, okay, that is. Okay, so this is when I switch on the laser, there's some transient here. I go to steady state here, and then now I zoom on what's happening over here. And okay, let's go to a log scale. It will be easier to see. you see that when I switch off the laser, there's a the blue. So the black one is the single atom decay, and the blue one is the faster decay here, and then the slower decay here. Okay, so this is super radiant subradiants. So now you have the code. With this code, you can simulate many things. So everything Anna talked about in the linear chain, or take a square array, and all this, everything is done in this code. You just arrange the position of your atoms differently. You can simulate all this metamaterial stuff with this code. So it's a very efficient code. I use it for disordered system, but you don't need to take the rand in this here. So you just position your atom here as you want, on the lattice, on the chain, whatever, and you get all these results which you have seen in previous talks. You can also add the one of our cube term here, which is a little bit nasty, but it's possible. So we did it, some people did it, but to get a start, do it with this model. It's much easier, a lot of fun. So you can get a lot of fun out of this, but at the end of the day, you have to go to this full model. Okay, so this was numerical simulations. Yeah, so we did this, couple dipole model, and that's the code, and this was the result, so which I showed you. So super radiant subradiants is easily, we can solve it in less than a minute here. We see the effect, and then you change parameters, so it's a quite easy calculation. You don't need DRMG or high quantum simulation computers to do this. Okay, so now we want to do to go for experiments. So what can you do? So there's a this field has been studied in extent in the 70s, 80s, and so on. It has been revived to some extent by Marlin Scully, and he called this single photon super radiance for many atoms. And this single excited state, the super radiant state, is this symmetric state here, which we heard about by Anna and Antoine. I will not go into too much detail here about this symmetric state because time is going on and you already saw it. I want to show you some results and hopefully come to the third lecture about Anna's localization. We'll see. Okay, so there have been many experiments over the last 10 years about super radiance, so about the fast decay. Almost everything you can understand by looking at the Fourier transform of a mean field effect. So if you just look at the forward transmission of the beam in the Beer-Lambert direction, so in the forward direction, you have this index of refraction which describes this cloud of cold atoms like an effective medium. And we know that if you look at the intensity, you get this, if you have few atoms, you get a Lorentzian dip here, and if you have more atoms, you get the exponential of a Lorentzian, which looks like this. And in frequency space, if you have more atoms, this response gets broader in frequency, which means if you go for Fourier space, it's faster. So you can get most of the super radiant effect just by Fourier transform this effective medium regime. I will not study this. I will focus more on this long-lived time, which are not so easy to get out. And so the question is, how can you make an atom stay in the excited state, stay longer in the excited state than in single atom? There are many ways how to make it decay faster, but how to make it live longer in this excited state. So there have been a couple of experiments with two atoms to study this. One has been studied by Alain Aspect in the experiment where he tried to, where he also studied entanglement, so the famous Aspect experiment in the beginning of the 80s. So what they also had, at some point they had two atoms flying apart, and then the atoms could emit photons, and they could see fringes here, which is like a Young double slit fringes, because at different time here, the atoms have different positions, and the fringes will oscillate on the detector. So there was an oscillating part here already they could see, but they could not see, as they write here, a modification of the lifetime, because the typical distance, if you look at the timescales here, they had a KR of 36. And KR of 36, if I come back to this previous picture here, KR 36 is way over here. So we are very close to the single atom limit. But you can still make interference between two beams which are meters apart. So the interference part is much more robust than the modification of the lifetime. So they could not see the modification of the lifetime because the distance was too large. But there was a Brewer who took ions, who could trap ions at a distance, much smaller distances, for longer time, so you could do much better time results experiments. And he had a distance here, KR of 19, so he was sitting over here for the different experiments. So we could see a modification of the spontaneous emission lifetime and see lifetime smaller than single atom or faster. So we had super and sub-radians here, which were well visible here, so that's signal to noise ratio. So you could see modification of the lifetime when there were two atoms, two ions hold together at a close distance. So for two atoms, the only parameter which you can control is the distance. So it's not this cooperativity parameter I introduced before. So there's been some experiments trying to look for subradiance from an inverted system with many atoms, but so there was there's a paper here about by Pierre Pillet about subradiance, but it's from an inverted system and pair physics are involved, and at the end of the day, the duration of their ringing here cannot be longer than the single atom decay for because basically they have the pencil shape excitation. So along this direction, the optical depth is large, but along this direction, the optical depth is small. So photons can always escape in the transverse side, so you cannot keep it live longer in the system for because of this transverse limitation. So what you need to do to get subradiance is you need large optical depth in all directions. Okay, so we like spherical clouds. It does not require large spatial density. Again, this is important. So this parameter here, squared. So this is not the spatial density. The spatial density goes like n over kl cube. Okay, it's a small change, 2 to 3. It's a big difference in the experiment. This means this goes like the optical depth, and it's very easy in most of the mods you can produce nowadays to get a large optical depth, but the distance between the atoms is still much larger than the wavelength. So what we exploit here is this 1 over r part of this Green function, and it's known from long-range physics like gravitational physics, Coulomb physics, that if the interaction decays slower than the dimension of the space, so if you have a if you're in space of dimension d and you have an interaction r to the alpha, if alpha is smaller than d, actually it's not the nearest neighbor which is important, it's how many atoms or how many particles are connected together. So in 3D, if you have 1 over r, we are clearly in this long range limit. If you have 1 over r cube and with this oscillating part, it's on the edge. But 1 over r, we are clearly in the long range limit, so we do not depend on the spatial density, but on the how many atoms we have, and it scales like 1 over kl squared. Okay, and so even near field effects might be bad, so there's a nice review paper by Serge Haroche in the 80s, Michel Gross, where they think that even if you have too many atoms too close, they might deface this synchronized quadrupole motion, and this might even kill subradiance. But maybe more about this later, but probably not today. Okay, and then decoherence, we don't know how decoherence will affect this, because this long-lived state is like a metastable state. So if you have phonons or anything kicking this metastable state, maybe it's not a good idea. But so we don't know exactly how fragile this is for phonons and the other mechanisms of decoherence. Okay, so the idea is to measure this. So we want to find lifetimes which scales like this cooperativity parameter here, B0. That's what I already showed you. And we want to make sure that we don't get fooled by our glass of milk experiments, right? So we had photons living in the glass of milk for a very long time, and the time scale scales like B of delta squared. So it's a diffusion model. It depends on the mean free path. So it depends on the detuning of the laser. So there's a delta depending here. It's just B0 here. It does not depend on the detuning. And there's a square here. There's no square here. So it's very different scaling law. So to distinguish subradiance from radiation trapping, we have to look at how it's not just have a long lifetime. It's easy to get a long lifetime. Take a big container of milk, put an optical fiber in the center, it will take long time for the light to get out. But it's not subradiance, it will be radiation trapping. So you have to look at the scaling law, so you have to change this parameter and see how the things scale to make the difference between a coherent effect to keep the photons in the system for a long time and an incoherent random walk model. And if you have Anders localization, no one really knows. The speculation would be that there's an exponential dependence here, but okay. So far we don't claim this. This would be a bigger claim. So we stay modest and we try to see this. This is some results comparing random walk model and a couple dipoles. So this is a given optical depth on resonance and then increase the detuning. So the optical depth gets smaller at the laser frequency where I work. So radiation trapping gets faster and faster exit times. So if you have a large optical depth, photons stay in the system for a long time. So that's radiation. That's a diffusive model. That's random walk, which is a little bit more general than diffusive. And the coupled dipole model, which I just showed you, even in the very small optical depth, so if you're large detuned, and in my simulation I had a detuning which was large, so B of delta in the simulation I showed you was smaller than one. So I was in limit where radiation trapping would not affect lifetimes, but subradiance here saturates to a number well above one, which is not given by this B of delta scaling. Okay, so then we want to do the experiment. So the experiment is you just reproduce this. Switch on laser, switch off laser, look at light. That sounds easy. There's a lot of problems, a lot of technical problems, and for this you need excellent experimentalists to do this, which is not me. We'll come back to that at the end. Some people know how to handle this, and if you just take most of the detectors in lab, it will not work. You have afterpulsing, oscillations in the fast decay. So we found a detector, which is a hybrid detector, which we can switch off the laser very cleanly. So we can switch off a laser, that's good news. We can switch it off quickly. So this is, we can switch it off in with an AOM in less than 10 nanoseconds. And we can switch it off by many orders of magnitudes. You see here, we can switch it off by at least 4 orders of magnitudes. So we can make on off with a dynamic range of 10 to the 4. This is not so easy. But this is important, as you will see later, because the signal we will see will be signal at the very low level here. So if you don't only have a 1% precision, you will not be able to see subradiance. Okay, so the experiment is here. We prepare our cloud of cold atoms, switch everything off, and then come in with a series of laser pulses here. So there was 12 pulses of 30 microseconds here, a large laser beam to cover the whole cloud, and we zoom at the switch off of every pulse here. What is nice here is that between the pulses, the cloud will expand, and we get different values of B0 in the same run. So that's a nice feature. And then what we see is this. So we switch off the laser beam, and basically everything drops up to 10 to minus 3. And then we see some light coming out. And so what we see here is it's a low level. So you need to be able to detect low level of intensities. And here we have the influence of the cold atoms here. So light stays in the system for a longer time. And if you have large optical depths, the photons stay in for longer time. So this is good. So more atoms, more lifetime. That's good. But you have to check more for the scaling law. And if you change the tuning, the slope doesn't change. You get more of it, but the slope does not change. So the lifetime, which is the slope of this exponential decay here, does not depend on detuning. So that's very important. And then we do some fit on this lifetime here to get the amplitude of this subradiant state and the decay time. And then if you plot everything together on a single plot here, this is the lifetime of this subradiant state for a large range of parameters, different detunings, different B0s, and they all fall on universal line. So it's not radiation trapping because it does not depend on detuning and it has not the square dependence here. So this is verifying this subradiant state. So we have seen basically two ways how to trap a photon for a long time, radiation trapping and subradiance, and they both work. Radiation trapping is much easier to do, but this also exists. Why this here?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is, there was some, in this plot here, these are the values of the largest B0, that's the initial state of the atoms, and there were some problems in calibration of the B0. So this is, right now we go a little bit higher. Not on this one. Okay, I will show you. So this is a technical issue about the system. So we have to, this is really the smallest cloud we had, so there were some normalization issues here. Okay, so this is subradiance. Okay, not so, it's okay. One thing which is nice, which is not really pushed forward so far is that, so it's a small value, so it's little, not so much light, but the slopes are very long, so you get a long lifetime. And so yeah, I would have to stress this. The lifetime is not 10% longer than single atom, it's 2 orders of magnitude longer than single atom. So it's a huge increase of lifetime. So we can really change the order of magnitude of how long does a photon stay in this system. Okay, and if you look at the how much energy is stored in this single excitation subradiant manifold, you take the lifetime, so the basically you take the energy here, the surface, so the lifetime times the amplitude. So let's say 10 minus 3 and the lifetime of 100. So this gives 10%. So it's not so small in terms of energy. But it's not ever so. There, of course, most of the light will couple to the symmetric state because the symmetric state is well coupled to the outside world. So it's much easier to couple to the super radiant modes. But OK, 10% is not so bad. OK, let me see. We started a bit earlier, yes, but I won't go to the third lecture. So we can do a lot of analysis on these things. And you have it in lecture notes. But and we can look at what type of modes we excite. I will just trip it, just a flash on this. So what we had seen in the lectures by Anna and Antoine is sometimes the eigenvalues of this effective Hamiltonian, which I will come back to it at the end. So this is this type of plot. So if you diagonalize this green function, there's an imaginary number. There's an IKR in this green function. So you get complex eigenvalues. The real part we can consider like a shift of this mode. And the imaginary part is the lifetime of this mode. So for single atom, everything would be at 0 here, at 1 here. So that's a single atom response. And if you get more atoms, you get shifts all over the place. And you get fast decaying modes and slow decaying modes here. So that's, let's call this the super radiant modes and the sub radiant modes. But you can push this analyze a little bit further by looking if these modes are extended or not extended. And actually what you can see is that there's this like bluish modes here. So the red modes here, they are extended mode. There's either extended mode in the fast decaying limit, so super radiant mode, or in the slow decaying limit, sub radiant modes. But there are also other modes here, which are in blue here, which are not extended. So this is the partition ratio, which tells you how many atoms participate in every mode here. So every point here is an eigenmode of this effective Hamiltonian. And the color code is how many atoms participate in this eigenmode. So the red basically is that everyone participates. And the blue is less atoms participate in this eigenmode. So there's some modes here which seem to behave differently. And this we interpret like rotation trapping modes. So rotation trapping, multiple scattering is also included in this model. And the modes behave a little bit different. So the question is, what type of things do we excite when we do an experiment? Do we excite sub-radiant modes, super-radiant modes, rotation trapping modes? And to study this a little bit more precisely, we did an experiment. Instead of having a large laser beam, we use a small laser beam. So we could favor the excitation of these rotation trapping modes. And so what you can see here is that, so again, I switch off the laser beam here. The blue line is single atom decay. So everything you see here is long-lived modes. But there's these long-lived modes here, which are quite long-lived, which we associate to radiation trapping. And then we have these very long-lived modes, which we associate to subradiance. By looking at how they scale, we can do this. So radiation trapping and subradiance, they coexist at the same time. It depends on which modes do you exist. So these modes exist, and what do you populate? So it depends how you prepare your sample. You can excite the sub-radiant mode, super-radiant mode, and there might be other tricks to selectively couple more to one mode or to the other mode. But they coexist. The modes exist in the system. Depends what type of modes you excite. And you can do scaling laws for this, but I will not go into this. The other important question is how robust is this when atoms move? And so this is, again, the coupled dipole equation I showed you before. Okay, if I want to simulate this in the code I had, I just put the positions of the atoms. So I add a Doppler shift here for the laser drive. Okay, that's easy. And in the green function here, I make the positions of every atom time dependent with their initial velocity. So we can write this. So we can simulate in the numerics how this should evolve. But we can try to think what would be a good guess. How robust is this subradiant system to motion? So my initial guess was that if subradiant is kind of a metastable state, and if the lifetime of this metastable state is tau sub, so if I have a lifetime of tau for subradiants, this gives me a width of this state which goes like this. So if kV is larger or smaller than this width of this excited state, then this might destroy it or not. So I don't want to get Doppler broadening out of this state. So the initial guess would have been KV larger or smaller than gamma sub would be a limit where subradiance would be killed. So if KV is larger than this, you would kill subradiance. So that was a guess. It's not what we see in the numerics. The numerics allows us to go to very high temperature, but it's not what we see in the numerics. And also in the experiment, which are reproduced by the numerics. So this, again, we heat up our sample from 50 microkelvin to 10 millikelvin, so it's a big range of temperatures. And just as an example here, this line here would be this limit here for 50 microkelvin, and 50 microkelvin we get lifetimes much longer than this. So so in general we can get lifetimes which are not limited by this criterion here. The question is why? There are a couple of guesses. Maybe we have an adiabatic following of all these eigenmodes, so we cut from one subradiant mode to another subradiant mode, and from here we see that there are more subradiant modes than superradiant modes. So maybe if you have motion, you couple from this mode to this mode to this mode and so on, but you stay over here, and you would only lose the atoms if you couple to the other state here. So, but we don't have an analytical expression on this, but this is a guess. Numerics and experiments confirm that subradiant so far is quite robust. We saw that going backscattering also lives up to some limit, and then it will break down if the atoms move faster than the light in the multiple scattering limit. Here it's quite robust, and so that's a good surprise, which allows us to be optimistic if you want to go for the next step, which is Anders localization. Okay, then there is another thing. What happens if I go to more than a single photon? So the linear scattering regime is this optical coherence property here. The question is, can we do something fancy with a single photon in the system? So no double excitation, but a single photon, but no optical coherence initially. Okay, so instead of having our coupled dipole approximation, which is based on this optical coherence, start from not a coherence, but start from one excitation somewhere. One atom or one superposition of atoms excited. No coherence between the ground state and excited state. What will happen? This is not captured by linear optics. So it's a single photon, but it's not linear optics. The question is, what will be the decay curve of this? To solve this, you need to take this quantum model. You cannot use the coupled dipole equation, because the coupled dipole equation is only looking at this oscillation of the betas, which are the optical coherence. This coupled dipole model does not tell you anything about the population which is not connected to the square of the optical coherence. So if it's different, then the coupled dipole equation doesn't work. So the question is, what is the dynamics? So if someone has a full quantum model, Q-tip or whatever, solve it compared to the coupled dipole model. Tell me how it looks, how different it is. It should be different, and that would be nice to see. So homework number two, second paper of the consortium. Okay, so we have two papers coming out. So it's Jean-Michel will be happy. We go to PRX for the whole thing, we'll see. Okay, so with this, so that's a summary of this second part, and now I will go to the third lecture, so I skipped some parts, but that's not so bad, because it's getting late. And I thought that, okay, do your homework, and so you come back with the results on the next lecture, so by email, Mathilde will take care of this. Okay, so now let's switch to the third lecture. Questions on this subradiance, because that's already not so bad. It's a new thing, so it's something which is related to what you heard from Anna and from Antoine. You have numerical codes. It works in the experiment. We understand more or less. We have no analytical expression. Okay, so one thing we don't have is we don't have any analytical expression even for the single scattering limit. So no multiple scattering. We don't know the analytical shape of this. Should be able to be derived from this coupled dipole equation, but okay, that's we don't know. But besides this, we are happy because we see it, and now we can play with it. Now we want to exploit these things to do different stuff. Questions? No? Okay, I go for the third lecture. Okay. Number three. There's no homework in number three because there was no supposed lecture after number three, but number two there was. Okay, so analysis localization. So I will try to give you some introduction about what analysis localization is, a little bit of history. Obviously, I cannot do everything. This will require 2 weeks of full lectures by many other experts, but okay, just some glimpse on what's going on. Then I will come back to this green function effective Hamiltonian, which will now be exploited extensively here. And then I will tell you this. This I have to tell you. I might skip many things, but this I have to tell you, because basically there was a very important paper saying that it might not be possible to do analysis localization with light by cold atoms. And then, okay, of course we don't believe everything immediately, so then we see how we can go around this important paper here. Okay, so this is the initial paper by Anderson. So it says that if you have a random lattice, we'll come back to this random lattice model, at some point you will not, if you have random motion, you expect diffusion, L squared over tau, but that's in some limits this diffusion will be frozen, and this is what he came up with here. So that's the basic idea, and I will show you how this works. He also said that if you have long range interaction, I will come back to this in next slide, all this might break down. And actually, in our case, it does not break down, so there's some things still to be understood. So there's, if you read this, there's still things to be connected between our coupled dipole model and this Anderson model, which are not completely understood, at least not by me. Okay, so what is this random Anderson lattice model? So forget about the light scattering first. So it was a closed system, a Hamiltonian system, so you have a lattice. You have different positions, so it's 3D. You can do it in 2D and 1D as well, but the main interest will be in 3D, but okay, this is a picture of 2D. So these are all the sides here, and the atom can hop from one side to the other, tunneling, or we have a coupling from one side to another. This is the coupling here, coupling rate here, tunneling rate, let's say, going from side I to side J. So that's in the matrix of the coupling matrix will be off diagonal. You go from I to J, and then you have energy on every side, that's the diagonal part of this Hamiltonian, and this is the energy Ej of every side, you put an energy on this. And so the idea is to take this energy first to be a random number. So if there's no randomness on this energy, you get a block band, that's a lattice, you get the block eigenstates. And if you put some randomness on the diagonal part here, what you can see is that if you look at the eigenstates, eigenvalues of this, they will no longer be extended, but if this disorder here, W, is 16 times larger than the tunneling rate, then suddenly all the states become exponentially localized. So you kill all these extended states and you get only localized states. This means that if you excite a site here, in a block state, the electron will travel across the system, but if you have a localized state here, but the electron will stay here, it cannot travel. So this is a transition from a conductor to an insulator. That's why this is so important in this context. There's a trivial limit. If you have an infinite amount of disorder, which means every site has a completely different energy, then you can forget about tunneling and every eigenstate is just a single site occupation. So there's a trivial limit. But the interesting thing is, how do you go from conducting limit to the insulating limit? So what type of phase transition do you have? Can you probe this phase transition? The two extreme limits are trivial more or less, but the transition is the interesting part. And so this was the initial idea by Anderson, and there has been a lot of work by many experts over the last many decades. I just show you one result here, which is the scaling theory of localization by a paper called Gang of Four. There are four authors on this paper. And the idea is the following. If you know something about a small, so you take your sample and you take a small piece of the sample and you try to understand how the conductivity properties are for this small sample. So a small 1 millimeter cube box, and you look at the conductivity of this box, can you understand, if you take this box now twice larger in every dimension and you make it larger and larger, how does this conductivity scale? And they came up, so this is the conductivity G, and this is a reduced dimensionless conductance here, small g. And so what you can show is that, so what they showed in this paper is that if you take this function here, which is the derivative of the logarithm of G, by the derivative of the log of the size of the sample, there are different possibilities. Let's say if the sample gets bigger, then you go along this line here, which means in 1D, you will always go to a limit where this G gets exponentially small, which means this will always be an insulating state. In 2D as well, and in 3D, if you have a large log of G, then at some point there's a crossing of this beta equals zero line here. Beta equals zero means a change of sign. If you change the system size, either the conductivity gets larger or smaller. So that's this beta crossing of zero is where when you increase the system size to get to macroscopic scales, either it becomes more and more conductive or more and more insulating. So that's the important point. So I won't have time, but so there's some limits. So the metal limit here, we know that Ohm's law for electrons is that the conductivity goes like L to the D minus 2. So in 3D, it's 1 over L, the resistance, so Ohm's law. And this gives you the beta if you do drive this D minus 2, which means for D equals 1 and 2, this is always negative. And for D equals 3, this is positive in this limit here. And for an insulator, you're in this regime here. Okay, so this was a very important paper because it gave some qualitative scaling law, how things should happen, and that dimension is very important. 3D is very important, and it's supposed to be universal, which means it does not depend on what system you have. It does not depend on microscopic details. You take electrons, you take photons, matter waves, acoustic waves, whatever you take, it should work. It's just a scaling law. So it depends on dimension, but it does not depend on the details of the disorder. So that was the state of the art until a few years ago. Okay, there have been other people working on many things, scaling theory, self-consistent theory of localization, which is basically taking Cohen backscattering in loops. So you have a Cohen backscattering, and during this Cohen backscattering, so we have this loop here, we make this loops here, this Cohen backscattering loop, and in every loop you make another loop, and here you make loops and loops and loops and loops. And from this you can predict also a phase transition. So this was is a very nice thing. It's known to give the wrong results quantitatively, but it's at least analytical derivation. And basically most people use numerical simulations of toy systems, including us. And then there are many tools how to analyze the data, to make scaling laws, eigenvalue statistics, come back to this, partition ratio, already spoke about this, finite size scaling, you need to extract the critical exponent at the phase transition, multifractal behavior. So there are many, many things you can do, and if you want to enter this field, it's heavy because many people have done nice things, but the good thing is that you can go shopping. You take this from this guy, this from this guy, and then you do your cooking, and you apply to your system. So that's what we do. Okay, so what has been done in answer localization? So in 1D, again, 1D and 2D, there's no phase transition, and many things have been done, and it's basically understood. There's no controversy about in 1 and 2D about localization. Just a kind of summary. So in cold atoms, Mark Reisen did a kicked rotor, which is an equivalent, a mapping to Anders localization in 1D. Azi Genak, one of these pioneers in microwaves, did experiment in quasi-1D in microwaves. Alain Spey and in the Florence group did experiment in Bose-Einstein condensate in 1D. So one matter waves, microwaves, cold atoms, all this works. In 2D, there's been experiment in microwave cavities, which also show localized states here. And there's been a transport here along a network of random position fibers, it also localizes. So 1 and 2D, no controversy. In 3D, this has been a much more disputed thing. People try to do this in 3D, and there have been indeed 3D experiments which have seen localization in acoustics, cold atoms, and in matter waves. So this was done, so you see this is quite recent. Well, maybe not for you, for me it's quite recent. Compared to what Anderson did 50 years ago, this is quite recent. And it's still ongoing experiments, so all this is still ongoing. So this is acoustic B, so there are alumina spheres here which are raised together, so it's a network, so it's a hoping model from one B to the other. And they saw localization in this system here. The cold atom experiment of Mark Reisen has been generalized to 3D by multi-frequency kicking in Lille, and they have seen the nice phase transition with scaling laws here, finite size scaling here. So this has been seen, and matter wave experiments have been done in the Spey group and in Florence as well, where they've seen that there's a part of the matter wave which has been put into a speckle disordered potential doesn't spread away, it stays confined, so it's localized here. So all of this is still ongoing research in all this, but it's not about scattering problems with the green function we discussed in the coupled dipole model. So what my interest is in this here for the rest of the talk is what happens if you take a scattering problem with this green function, with this long range green function, because in the Anderson paper, long range should kill localization. So it's not so. This is not the long range. None of those are long range problem. And so people try to do this with light. Okay, light is also a non-interacting wave. So people try to do this with light. There have been two pioneers. I come back to these two pioneers because they really showed the way for the whole community. At Larendijk, with Dietrich Wiersma, did experiment in the end of the 90s. And they looked at the modification of Ohm's law, which I showed you in the first lecture, this Ohm's law 1 over L. It should go over, if you have localization, to an insulator with exponentially decaying transmission. And at the critical regime, there should be 1 over L squared. They saw 1 over L squared behavior here. They published this in the end of the 90s. There have been some discussions. And now it's agreed on, including the authors of this paper, that this experimental signal has been masked by absorption. So they use semiconductor powders, because what you want to have is KL of order of one, this what I introduced in this weak localization context. So you need a scattering which is very efficient. And if you take something which has a high index of refraction, it's a very efficient scatterer. So semiconductor powder have an index of refraction of above 3, so it's a very efficient scatterer. So they used semiconductor powders. But they also have a lot of absorption. So that was the main problem in this experiment here. Then a couple of years later, the other pioneer, Georg Maret, both of them were pioneers for Cohen backscattering already. I showed you the papers of these people in the 80s. So 20 years later, they still work on this. So it's a really, they dedicated part of their career to this. So he found a trick how to get rid of this absorption problem by doing time-resolved experiments. So he took a white paint, TiO2, compress it very hard to get KL very small, and look how light goes through as a function of time. And what I showed you in some of the codes, the diffusion model would give this red line, so the exponential decay here. Okay, that's the diffusion model. And he saw some light leaking out a little bit later. So he said, wow, this is the right regime where I expect under localization, photons stay in the system for longer. But this also, at the end, turned out to be a problem because he had to very few photons go through, so it's a very hard experiment. So he had to crank up the intensity of the laser to see something, and then he excited, there was nonlinear optics going on in this TiO2. You excite some states, you have fluorescence of this white paint, and this was the fluorescence decay of the white paint. So, Georg Maret in this paper also agrees that this is not a signature of localization. So far, no one has seen localization of light. Okay, and we'll see in a few slides that maybe it does not exist. So, okay, but. This paper, this work has been done in the end of 90s, end of 2000. So it's hard work. It's difficult to make the data analysis, but it shows us where problems lie. So if we do not know what people have tried and where the problems were, we will be unable to see anything reasonable. This is a slide I like a lot because it's kind of a summary of everything. It should have been before, but okay. So there are different ways how to keep a photon in the sample for a long time. We know radiation trapping. So radiation trapping is I throw photons, we are all called atoms. A photon is jumping from one atom to the other. It takes a long time, goes back and forth, and then leaves after some time. Radiation trapping, B of delta squared, lifetime. Subradiance, so subradiance is this extended modes. So this means it's an extended state. So all of us, we know that there's a photon, and we just oscillate in and out of phase. But we all know that there's a photon in the system. So you know there's a photon, you know there's a photon, you share the photon. It's a collective mode. And Anders localization is a system where the photons only is trapped in few atoms. So the other atoms don't know that there's a photon trapped here. So there are different ways to trap a photon for a long time. Two schemes are based on interference effects, and one scheme just on random walk. So the whole goal is to understand the interplay between all this. How do you go from one to the other? Are the phase transitions wrong here, here, and so on? And all this is part of the study of this coupled dipole model. And in terms of scattering green field paths compared to decoherence, you have random walk, weak localization, and if you get this scattering mean free path smaller than the wavelength, that's where we expect the underlocalization according to this regulated criterion. Okay, so now I try to, so far no one has seen it. No one has seen it, so we could stop here, but I try to give you a little bit of where does the community go? What are our tools, our hopes, what can we do? So to do this, we do some theory. So we take this effective Hamiltonian model again. So this is what we saw previously. So this is this single atom. So if you have this energy of every atom on site on position I, this is a free decay. We trace over the vacuum mode. So it's we get this linear optics coupled dipole model. So that's a free decay. That's why there's an I here. And then we have the jumping from of an excitation from atom J to atom I here, with some green function here, which tells us how we couple or we tunnel from one side to the other. Okay, so this looks like the off-diagonal part, like the tunneling part, which has this ugly green function near field, far field component. And there's a diagonal part here, which for now we just take as a constant here. So in contrast to the Anderson model, it's an open system. So there's an I over here. There's imaginary parts over here. So it's a little bit more messy compared to the Anderson model, which is a Hamiltonian system. But it has some disorder in the off-diagonal part. And this you can show if you take the Anderson model and just put disorder on the tunneling part, it also localizes. So that's OK. And there's long-range part here. So there's 1 over R here, which according to Anderson is a bad thing to have. So this should, if you would be able to kill this, there might be hope to get it. But you will see it's not exactly like this. And OK, there's no decoherence, so that's OK. This is fine. So one thing we did, and I will just skip this because it's too complicated. Okay, so you can look at this effective Hamiltonian and look at the eigenvalues of this effect. You have the notes, so you can read it. But it's, it will require to make a jump, and it's too tiring at this time a week. So we look at the eigenvalues of this effective Hamiltonian. So one way to look at this, so we are all called atoms, but we have collective modes. So we are like a big molecule, okay? So a big molecule, and we want to get the spectrum of this molecule, basically. If I drive the laser, and if all these atoms are very independent, it's I get a single Lorentzian shape. If the atoms come closer together, then I get narrow and broad lines. So this looks like a big molecule. So this is a molecule which is bound by the photons and not by the electron orbitals. So it's an optical molecule somehow. And so then we can try to see this statistics of this type of spectra. So now we look at the spectra of this big molecule. And the same things have been done in different communities, nuclear physics, semiconductor physics, and they give it different names, but it's the same type of equation and the same type of analysis. But so we just go for our community. So again, here is what I show for two atoms. This was how the lifetime of this super and subradiant state change as a function of distance. So if the atoms are close together, I have a long lived time, gamma is almost zero, and the superradiant state, and then it oscillates and goes to the single atom limit. And the energy shift is atoms are close together, the real part of these eigenvalues, they get shifted away. So there's a divergence here if the atoms come close together. Okay, there's a shift in the frequencies, and there's a modification of the lifetime. Now, instead of plotting gamma as a function of distance and the energy as a function of distance, I plot gamma as a function of energy. I see this spiraling in eigenvalues. So this is the case where the atoms are very far away. If the atoms come closer together, one eigenvalue will go to 2 here, super radiant state. One goes to 0, subradiant state. And the energy gets shifted away. Okay, that's for two atoms, just to show you how we plot things. Now we do it for n atoms, so we get not two values. So now I take a given position of the atoms, and I get many eigenvalues. So I have many atoms all over the place. Here I have 500 atoms. And some of the atoms, so some of the eigenvalues, they follow this spiraling line. And this is just pairs of atoms which are close together, which don't really care about the rest of the cloud. So some of the eigenvalues I can identify as pair physics, because they really follow this analytical curve of the pair physics. And other eigenvalues just get collective modes, and they get collective shifts and broadening all over the place. And here I compare the model where I take this simplified green function, just the 1 over R, or the correct full green function where I get more eigenvalues. I get also subradiant states, superradiant states. So it looks more or less similar. So now we try to understand a little bit how this changes when we enter this regime where we expect endless localization. That's the goal. So this is a plot of eigenvalues when you have KL smaller than 1. Okay, it can look nice. You see these arms here is around 2. So this is super radiant pairs. Okay. Then you get sub radiant pairs here in the tails here, the legs. And then you get all this here. And okay, I don't know if he's smiling or not. That's Yeti coming out. We want to understand how these eigenvalues, what is this eigenvalues? Are these super radiant, sub radiant, radiation trapping, unders local, what type of behavior these eigenvalues have? That's the goal. This is another way to plot this Yeti, comparing the scalar model, so the simplified model, which works very well for most of the experiments we have done so far, and the full model taking into account the one over the near field, one over cube terms, which is written loosely here. It's not exactly like this, but you take the full model, and you see if you have a large density, so KL smaller, very small, so the atoms are very highly packed close together, then these two models are very different. You see, okay, so first for the upper limit here, the super radiant part is not so badly described by the long range part. So you don't really need to care so much about the near field terms if you look at this upper branch here. Also the pairs here, obviously there's a pair physics here for two atoms, and the pair physics is here for near field. The splitting of the near field here gets much faster here because the one over r cube will make this diverge much faster. So you see pair physics different from the pair physics which is over here. So this slope here and this slope here is different because one over r and one over r cube will make a shift which is different. But mainly what is the main difference, so this is pair physics, but besides the pair physics, in the full model, there's kind of lower bound of the lifetimes of the eigenmodes here. Whereas in the scalar model, you can get very long lifetimes. So this is a big surprise. This, and we come back to this now, this was a big surprise. So this near field coupling term somehow makes modes not live long enough. Okay, so it looks a little bit like this van der Waals dephasing. So this 1 over r wants to get this very nice super separating states or long-lived states, and this 1 over r cube somehow kicks it away and makes it not live long enough. So this is numerical evidence, but we need to understand what's behind this. So one thing we what you can do, so one of the main players in this is Sergei Skipetrov, who has been a student by Roger Ménard, who is one of these experts on weak localization. Ménard, Ackermans, Lahrendijk, Maret, this group. And so now the next generation of people come and take over to study all this. Okay, so what you can do is you make level statistics, a little bit like in a transfer property. So if you look at how are these modes spaced? So you get narrow modes and you get broad modes, and you look at the average distance between modes compared to the average width of the modes. And if the modes do not overlap, this means this mode will not couple to this mode, and this is a good indication of a localized state because these modes are isolated. But if all the modes couple, you go from one mode to the other mode and you can go across the whole system. So we also did this, and you have to be careful, you can get fooled, okay? So we did this, just look at this lower plot here, because time is running. So this is this equivalent of this dimensionless conductance here. And you see that if I increase the sample size here, for some density, so if I have a dilute system, the density is small, this parameter here goes up. And if I have larger density, this goes down. So there's a change of the sign of the slope of this curve here to this curve here. So if I take the derivative of this curve here, this will be positive, this will be negative. And this is what this beta function means. This is in the scalar case. If I take the near field model, there's never a negative slope. It's flat or positive. And we can plot this now here as a function of this beta function here. In the scalar case, sometimes there's a negative slope here. So this part here, these points correspond to these points here, or positive slope, which over here. So there's a crossing of this beta function across zero. This is the indication of this phase transition which we want to have. So this scalar model has this Andersen phase transition, and it's close to this Eufforian criterion. So we're very happy that other localization should exist. It exists in this scalar model. The bad news is that if you do experiments, the photons have polarization. They have near field coupling. This dipole-dipole coupling has this 1/3 term. And if you look at the 1/3 term, if you do the scaling law, this slope is never negative. So beta is always positive. So there's no phase transition for the real photons if you couple real photons to classical dipoles. So the bad news, and this was published first by Sergei Skipetrov and Igor Sokolov, 2014, there is no phase transition for the real vectorial model with the near field coupling. A story to learn, if you do something a couple of months later, you go from PRL to PRA, that's life. And this happens every now and then to all of us, but okay, this is what's going on. We also studied this so in 3D, so and so here we fulfilled the Regel criterion. So the first thing is that this difference here has not been captured by this universal scaling law of the gang of four in the 70s. The idea was details, we don't care about details. And so vectorial model, scalar model, that's a detail about your system, photons, phonons, matter waves, it's a detail. But here we see that these details are very important. It makes a qualitative difference if the phase transition disappears by adding this detail of the near field coupling. So it's that's very important. And so we studied also this recently in 2D. In 2D, all states should be localized. And what we found is that even in 2D, that's not correct. In 2D, you have states which are not localized. So even in 2D, this is wrong. So these details about polarization make the story of localization completely different. So it's so light scattering by resonant dipoles is very different from this universal approach given by the gang of four in the 70s. Okay, so we'll skip this. Let's skip the 2D case. So okay, so the result is that there might be no underlocalization for vectorial light with near field coupling and polarization in 3D. So maybe this explains why the experiment didn't work, and this is like game over, go home, that's it. We will not do it. Again, university did not care about the details, but they have been very important. So this was in 2014. That's right now 5 years ago. But always, if there's a theorem saying a no-go theorem, read the small print, right? It's not always universally true. So there have been two methods which have been proposed since 2014 to go around this no-go theorem. One has been proposed by Sergei Skipetrov himself and Igor Sokolov. And it's a very strange thing, but it works. It's add a magnetic field. So I told you in the current backscattering lecture that a magnetic field might break reciprocity. That doesn't sound like a good idea to go for localization, but it works. So the idea is that you take a dense sample, KL equal 1, add a very strong magnetic field, and then you will shift all this. So the equivalent of a classical dipole is a 0-1 transition. Then you shift these levels by a lot, here by 1,000 or 2,000 gamma values. So you have a very large light shift. And then you tune the laser to one of this transition here. Either this one, or this one. So it's a little bit like what we did in current backscattering, where we could restore the coherence by following a stretched state. If you follow this stretched state here, this and this two stretched states, they show this localization transition, even though that there's this near-field dipole-dipole coupling included. And the other state doesn't have it. Okay, so there's a solution. Take this dense sample of atoms, add a strong field, and then try to do the experiment. So this is one possibility. So we might try this, someone might try this. It's a possibility. The other route which is possible is to do something different. I have time to do this. I like this idea, so I will explain it, because it's following the initial idea of Andersen. So we come back to the Andersen model and then connect from the Andersen model to subradiance and then go to localization. So it's exploiting all things I told you in the different lectures. And the idea is to add diagonal disorder in the system. The positional disorder, which is here, is the hoping from one atom. It's a green function, which is random. But there's no disorder on the diagonal in this green function. So the idea now is add disorder on the diagonal. And warning, this is not for young people under age of 10. Don't come here, don't listen to this. It's against the mainstream credo, because it doesn't require high spatial density. So this is a prediction of under localization of light if the atoms are at large distances, which is very strange. But okay, we can discuss it, but it's very strange means referee don't like it. So it's experts don't like it. I like it, but experts don't like it. Another thing is, okay, I showed you that the whole toolbox of how to analyze data, we take another tool. Because the first tool doesn't work. So it's always strange, but so we have to be careful. So we like the partition ratio as a measure. The partition ratio tells you how many atoms share a mode. If the partition ratio is large, then it's an extended mode. If it's small, then it's a localized mode. So we just checked that for this model here, the partition ratio captures the phase transition as well. So the partition ratio is a well-behaved measure of localization. It's extensively used in nuclear physics or other type of physics, but not so much used in our community, but it's it has been calibrated. Okay, so how do we do this Anders model? How do we add Daniell Zorda in our system? So I come back to this Anders model. So this is the model I showed you. Okay, so again, we put disorder on the positions here, and we have so far no disorder here in the first model. Oops, this is getting weak. No disorder on the hopping here for now. So that's that's an Anders model, and we know that in 3D, above 16.5, all states localize. But now I have to add the fact that we have a scattering problem and an open problem. We have these I's in this effective Hamiltonian. This here everything is real. All these are real values. But we have this, in the green function, we have this I all over the places. So we have to add opening. So the first thing we do a toy model, just a basic model to add an I in this. So we take this Hamiltonian, add a term with an I in here. And the model we use is that you couple every side here to a single outgoing mode. Okay, not many modes, not a lambda L over lambda squared mode. So just everything can decay to a single channel, which would be like a small volume limit. Okay, so now we have an I here, and then we expect from this I here, depending how important this I part will be, we can get super and sub radians, and depending on how disordered this is, we can get Anders localization. So this is shown here. So we look at the partition ratio here as a function of disorder, that's increasing disorder, and this is increasing opening. So first look at no opening, so along this line here, so this opening gamma is zero. So here I see extended state for small w, and then up localized state here above the Anderson transition 16.5 here. And I separated here fast modes and slow modes, but along this line it's exactly the same. If gamma is zero, there's no distinction. Now go along the w equals zero line. I know that if I increase disorder, I have the super radiant and the sub radiant states. So there's no big change here. There's a little bit of change here in the partition ratio for the super radiant state. So this is the super radiant state. This is sub radiant state. Now I combine both. I combine disorder and opening. And what I see is if I have a lot of opening, where I expect super and sub radiance be important, and I add disorder, the super radiant state don't see any longer this phase transition here. So the super radiant state do not get localized. They couple so well to the outside that they do not feel this disorder on the diagonal part. But the sub radiant state, they feel this disorder at the same strength of disorder, and they have this phase transition here. So we can also look at the eigenstates, and we can see that the eigenstates, depending how many disorder you have, how many atoms you have, you get this exponentially decaying peak of this localized component, and then you have a plateau here, which is the reminiscent of the of this extended subradiant state. So this is actually a hybrid state. It has a localized heart and a subradiant tail. Okay, so it's a hybrid state. It has both components, localized and subradiant. And so another way to think of this is that if you are deep in the subradiant state, basically you stay in the system, so you don't care about borders. You come back to the Hamiltonian closed system, and then you feel again the Anderson localized disorder system. If you are very open, then things change. So the superradiant modes are very open, and the subradiant modes, they are in a closed system. So it's almost like a Hamiltonian part, except this plateau here. Okay, so then we have to, so that was a toy model. The Anders model hoping on the lattice. So we now we apply this for our coupled dipole model with the Green function, and now we add the randomness here, and we do this analyzing with the phase transition. So if you have no disorder on the diagonal, there's no localized state, and if we have a disorder on the diagonal, we see this peak here with the plateau here. So as in the toy model, this predicts that we can get these localized states here, even in a limit where the density is smaller than the critical density for the previous part. So even in the low density limit, we expect by adding diagonal disorder to see localization. This is what we want to do. That's for Hector. This is then another one. So this is the goal. So we got the funding for this. That's the goal of the project. Okay, there's other things people don't like, but I will skip it because it's complex. We have a mobility edge along the imaginary axis, so it's very complicated. We get a scaling law, problem of transport. Okay, this is one of the questions. Okay, one important thing is how to measure this, because we don't have a way how to measure the eigenstates in the system. So transport is very difficult, because if you have this exponentially heart with tails, if you couple from the outside to the tail, you go on the other side of the tail, so the modes are still crossing the whole sample. So this hybrid nature is not good for transport properties. So we have to find another way to probe this system. And the way we come up is instead of looking at the transfer properties, we look at fluctuations. If you have a phase transition, fluctuations typically are enhanced. So we are going to look for fluctuations of the scattered light, and we are going to look at correlation functions, which Mathilde showed us how to do in the experiment, and then to detect on the correlation function G2 of tau how this is enhanced. And so we have some prediction about this enhanced fluctuation at the border of this localized transition. So this works for the Skippertroff model in the present magnetic field. We're applying this now for our diagonal disorder model as well. So that's where we want to, how we want to probe it, because we need to have a measure how to transport. This maybe not a good idea. It doesn't work really well. No one has seen, even in Merck's, signature on transport on this localization transition, maybe because of this hybrid nature of the eigenstates. And so maybe fluctuations is the way to go. Okay, with this I come to almost the last slide. So this is things I did not speak about. Okay, so that's for the next 10 years. Correlation functions, collective shifts, which are important for clocks, collective forces. So this is the thing, if you, of course, all this multiple scattering, random walk, separated mode, localized mode, they will change the intensity and the field locally in the sample. So this will exert forces on the atoms. So there's something, there will be strange things coming up. Okay, quantum optics, people already look for this. We also go for astrophysics. We like astrophysics very much, because you can go to nice places to do experiments instead of staying in the dark in your lab. But it's during at the night, so it's cold. And another thing, so one thing, okay, so I spoke about Dicke subradiance, Anders localization. They were both at Princeton in the 50s. The pioneers on the experiment we did in Nice was Guillaume Labéry for the current backscattering experiments and William Guérin for the separating experiments. And so now we try to combine all this together to do Anders localization of Dicke states, and we want to do it in Nice. And last but not least, all this, of course, it's an effort over many, many years by many, many people. So the present team, dream team in Nice is composed by Mathilde for the correlations right now, William for the subradiance, Guillaume for the backscattering and so on. Other people have been involved previously, Christian Manitura and David Tulkowski were there at the beginning of our effort in this. Anders Kasberg is now in our group. We have different postdocs. So Hector, Pierre and Alvaro will join our group on different projects right now. And very important is collaboration. So I still have 2 minutes. Collaboration is very important. So why are collaborations important? Collaboration is important first because you can meet people with different backgrounds, different cultures, so it's a very rich, just the human-wise, it's very rich. You can meet very interesting people, so it's really nice. Obviously, these people also know a lot about things you want to learn. So you see there's Eric Ackermann's in here, Dominique Gland, there's the initial days. So without them, we could not have done anything we have done so far. You can make all these people work on your project. So this is like extending your manpower by a lot. So it's very important. And all these people, they sign the papers with you. So if you sign a paper, basically your hand is trapped, right? So if they sign the paper, they agree with what we published. So it's really also a very important way. You cross-check what you say, what you think with these people. So it's really important. And most of these people can go to these places, so you can also exchange and travel to other places. So I think collaborations is a marvelous thing. And the way you already know each other here is a good seed for future for collaborations among yourself. So in the next 10 years, when you will be in your institutions, you will make collaborations among each other, send your students to different places. That's perfect. Okay, and with this, before taking questions, okay, this is the last lecture of these 2 weeks. I think we have to thank the organizers especially, and I think we should all thank Mathilde for this. It's a fantastic organization, very smooth, good atmosphere. It's all of you, of course, but I think the head is important for this. It's like in a big company. The spirit of the head is going through the whole thing, and I think this is thanks to Mathilde. So with this, thank you for everything, and I have a safe trip back. this is okay. This is Nice Airport. This is the mountains. So we are sitting over here right now. This is the this is Nice Airport, and this is how you land in Nice. That's why I say have a safe trip back. I have to go back home. Okay, so projection effect.